Canto 6, Chapter 4, and texts are many texts with no purport or short purport, so we'll read from 18 to 23.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Yatha sarsarja bhutani daksho duhirti vatsalaha. Retasa manasa shaiva tan mama vahita shino.
Translation. Sukadeva Goswami continued. Please hear from me with great attention how Prajapati Daksha, who was very affectionate to his daughters, created different types of living entities through his semen and through his mind. Purport. The word Duhitri Vatsalaha indicates that all the prajas were born from Daksha's daughters. Sri Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says that apparently Daksha had no son.
Manasai Vasajat Purvam Prajapatir Ima Prajaha Devasura Manushyadin Nabha Sala Jalao Kashaha.
With his mind, Prajapati Daksha first created all kinds of demigods, demons, human beings, birds, beasts, aquatics, and so on.
Text 20. Tam abrim hitam alokya praja sargam prajapati vindhya padan upavritya saucharad duksharam tapaha.
But when Prajapati Daksha saw that he was not properly generating all kinds of living entities, he approached a mountain near the Vindhya mountain range, and there he executed very difficult austerities.
Text 21. Tatra ghamarshanam nama tirtham papa haram param upasprishyanu savanam tapasato sayadharim.
Near that mountain was a very holy place named Aghamarshana. There Prajapati Daksha executed ritualistic ceremonies and satisfied the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, by engaging in great austerities to please him.
Text 22. Astau siddhamsa guyena bhagavantam adokshajam tubhyam tad abhi dasyami kasya tushyan yatha hari.
My dear king, I shall fully explain to you the hamsa guya prayers which were offered to the Supreme Personality of Godhead by Daksha, and I shall explain how the Lord was pleased with him for those prayers. Purport. It is to be understood that the Hamsa Guya prayers were not composed by Daksha, but were existing in the Vedic literature. So now we'll do text 23. Please repeat after me.
Shri Prajapati Ruvacha. Nama Paryavi Tathanu Bhutaye Gunatraya Bhasa Nimitta Bandhave Adrishta Dhamne Gunatattva Buddhivir Nivritta Manaya Dade Swayambhuve.
Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Prajapati Daksha said, the Supreme Personality of Godhead is transcendental to the illusory energy and the physical categories it produces. He possesses the potency for unfailing knowledge and supreme willpower, and He is the controller of the living entities and the illusory energy. the conditioned souls who have accepted this material manifestation as everything cannot see him, for he is above the evidence of experimental knowledge. Self-evident and self-sufficient, he is not caused by any superior cause. Let me offer my respectful obeisances unto him. The transcendental position of the Supreme Personality of Godhead is explained herewith. He is not perceivable by the conditioned souls who are accustomed to material vision and cannot understand that the Supreme Personality of Godhead exists in his abode, which is beyond that vision. Even if a materialistic person could count all the atoms in the universe, he would still be unable to understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead, as confirmed in Brahma Samhita 534, Panthastu koti shata vatsara sampragamayo vayo rathapi manaso mani pungavanam sopiyasti yat papada simni avichintya tatve govindam adipurusham tamaham bhajami. The conditioned souls may try to understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead for many billions of years through their mental speculative processes, traveling at the speed of the mind or the wind, but still the absolute truth will remain inconceivable to them, because a materialistic person cannot measure the length and breadth of the Supreme Personality of Godhead's unlimited existence. If the absolute truth is beyond measurement, one may ask how one can realize him. The answer is given here by the word Svayambhuve. One may understand him or not, but nevertheless he is existing in his own spiritual potency. So, these few verses that we read, chapter Hamsa Guhya Prayers, starting with text 18, Sukadeva Goswami, he is speaking to Prajapati. Prajapati Daksha is the one of the original persons empowered to fill up this universe with population. The universe is empty at one point in time, and then Lord Brahma, he starts the process, and then various other people in management of this universe, they are given different responsibilities and different powers by the original Supreme Person, Krishna. And through the expansion of their various departments that are set up, then this universe is filled up. So here we read that, and he's asking Prajapati Daksha, he's asking to hear this with great attention, about how Prajapati Daksha, he is creating different types of living entities through his mind and through his semen. So we have responsibilities, all of us, right? Somebody may be doing some responsibilities in book publication department, in the deity department, in prasadam preparation, in preaching, life membership. So many different types of duties are there. If we take this situation, even in our country, in India, yesterday I was discussing with somebody, it seems like a big job to manage how many is 1.3 something billion people, to arrange, to make sure they all have food and clothing and shelter and employment and houses and then education and health care and all these things. It's a big responsibility. Anybody here, you think you're qualified to manage this country? Anybody here thinks they can manage the state of Karnataka? How about managing even this temple? It's not an easy job. So, out of our community of devotees, so many nice things are being done in this temple, but it requires a certain kind of brain capacity and vision and empowerment to be able to do this. It's not every person can take charge of running a temple like this. So whether it's a temple or whether it's a state or whether it's the country of India, or if there was, like in previous times, only one emperor, and that emperor was responsible for running the entire planet with 8 billion people, it's not an easy assignment. So each person is given different amounts of powers to be able to do their duties. So Brahma is given responsibility to fill up the entire universe. It's a big assignment. Now, we can, if we really want to try all the different types of, you know, if you want to increase your job experience, you can become Lord Brahma. You have to perform austerities and, you know, certain qualifications have to be there. But in time, we can reach and occupy the position of Brahma. That is possible for each one of us. But is that what we want to do? Daksha, he has his own powers. So he is creating, we're reading here, he's creating all these different types of bodies. And these different types of bodies, it is described here in these verses, that the Supreme Lord is controlling two things, the illusory energy and the jivas. So that means each one of us is somehow controlled by the higher powers that be. There's very little freedom of choice we have. Many people, they're so proud of their freedom. I'm a free person, free country, free this, free that. Especially in the West, you know, certain countries, this liberty or this freedom is a big thing. But what freedom is there? Few choices we can make. You make slight a choice that is against the laws of nature, and immediately laws of nature, they come and they give us a big slap in the face. So slight freedom we have, but beyond that we are forced to enter these different types of bodies that Daksha is creating. It is described here that he is creating with his mind. Even here they say mental creation comes before physical creation. But this kind of creation Daksha is doing with his mind is seven. None of us have that power in these bodies that we have. So he's creating demigods, demons, human beings, birds, beasts, aquatics, so many forms. How many total forms are there that person in charge of creation under the jurisdiction of Lord Brahma, how many types of species there are? 8,400,000. It's quite a large production arrangement, huh? If we say that let's set up a factory in Bangalore, and from that factory we will create 8,400,000 species of life, is that within our capacity? No, we cannot do it. We cannot even create one type of creation. We are simply just forced to enter one of these forms of life. So that is the problem. The problem is that two things that are created, the illusory energy of the Lord, and then we are controlled, and we are put into the control of the illusory energy, which is controlled by Krishna. So right from the beginning, we are put into illusion. As soon as we enter this material world, immediately we are put into illusion. And that illusion makes us think that we belong to a certain species of life, or we have a certain kind of physical existence. Now, let's talk about diseases. This coronavirus, how long it's been here now in India? 2.5 years. And I think many devotees have got vaccination, but other devotees may have even gotten some coronavirus, some version, right? Some light, this and that. I know many people who got vaccination who got this also. 2 years disease. Any other types of diseases, like in my case, I'm starting to get, you know, I'm in my mid-70s. So you would expect that I have certain diseases, right? And some of them I've had for a few months, some for a few years, some for a little bit longer. But is that really the kind of disease that we're concerned about? How many types of diseases are there that this human body can take? Anybody knows? If you make a list of all the different types of cancers and viruses and flus and headaches and infections, how many types of diseases are there? Guess? Somebody can look on the phone quickly. Google. Whatever the number is, it is large, and the whole society, the whole so-called healthcare system is geared to try and deal with these diseases. Right? It's a big thing, healthcare. Unfortunately, the disease that we have been carrying, as we're reading from here, is much more serious than all these diseases we experience in this human form. It's a very serious disease. And what is that disease? That disease is that we are identifying with this bag of bones and blood and urine and stool and all kinds of horrible things are in this bag. It may be a brown bag or a young bag or older bag or a blue bag or a white bag or a yellow bag or a black bag. We're all thrown into these bags called these bodies. Not only one time, you know, let's say we have been in this bag for 20, 30, 40, 60, 80, 70 years, whatever. But before we got into this bag, this disease, there was some other disease bag we were in. And then before that, some other bag. Before that, some other bag. How many millions of years we've been living with this disease? How many millions of years? Anybody remembers? Coronavirus, you can say I had the disease 6 months ago. Or I had a flu. Anybody had a flu here recently? You had a flu. How long ago? 2-3 back. Okay. Thank. Good to see you here. That you recovered quickly. So flu comes, it goes quickly, right? 2-3 days, 5 days. Coronavirus comes, 1 month, it's over. But this real disease that we're carrying of being stuck in this bag, and this bag is a prison for us, and then we are thrown into this big prison house called the material world. How long has that disease been with us? Anybody remembers? Anybody remembers when you entered this disease condition? You remember all other kinds of diseases. Why don't you remember how long you have been in this diseased body? Because Krishna is very powerful. He can make us forget very easily, very quickly. My mother is now 93 years old in her body. 93 years old. Suffering so much. And she's been hearing Prabhupada's teachings, Vedic teachings for 40, 50, 60 years now. But the body is giving so much pain that she cannot get free from the pain to think about her real condition. She keeps saying, I had such a nice life. I was so happy, because she's thinking of the body. My body was giving hardly any pain. I had a good life. My husband was with me, because my father passed away 15 years ago. So now she's been a widow 15 years. So she's remembering those days when the disease was still there, but attacking, other diseases were not so prominent. So now this old age disease has become very strong, but she cannot somehow understand what the real disease is. Why? Because the body has become much more difficult to deal with. So therefore Prabhupada tells us that when you're young, develop your self-understanding, self-realization. Because we've been in this diseased condition for so long, millions of years, so many bodies, because of this disease of wanting to separate ourselves from reality, that we're not this body, we're some other person living within this body, this bag. So we've been living, carrying this disease for such a long time that we think this is natural. How many of you are thinking, be honest, it is natural to be in this body? Be honest. How many are thinking it is natural to be in this body? At least a few people, huh? We think it's natural to be in this body. How many of you are thinking it's natural to get sick once in a while? How many of you think it's natural to get sick once in a while? How many of you are thinking it's natural to be hungry for prasadam at a certain time? Now more hands are going up. How many of you are thinking that at some point in time you should take rest? There, more hands are going up. See, all of this has to do with this disease condition, this body. How many of you, and I'm speaking to myself also, are fully aware all the time that you're stuck in this horrible body full of horrible things, and that you're only 1/10,000 the size of the tip of the hair? That is your real size. 1/10,000 the tip of one hair. How many of you are aware of that condition all the time? It's difficult to do, no? All the time. That is self-realization. All the time, have no awareness of any other reality except that I'm tiny spirit soul, part and parcel of Krishna. And I'm somehow stuck within this body. I've had this disease not only for 1 week as a flu, or 1 month, or something more serious for many months or years, but I've had this disease for a very, very, very long time. And because I've had it for such a long time, I don't even know I have the disease. Right? That is the real problem. I don't even know I have the disease. That is what it means to be a conditioned soul. Conditioned soul has no idea what the reality is. All the time, from early morning to late at night, we are living in illusion. We're living with a false understanding, mistaken understanding. Whole day, whole week, whole month, whole year, we're living in that false conception. This is the nature of the conditioned soul. So what to do? Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita that this conditioned life, very difficult to break out of, right? But he gives a solution. He says, yes, it's very difficult to break out of this mistaken type of life, this disease that you've had for lifetimes. So, but he says if you do one thing, then very easily you can break out of this conditioned life. What is that? I'm sure you all know. Don't be shy. Chanting, but he gives specific that verse. He says, if you do this, then you can easily get out of this illusion, this false understanding. Sorry, loudly. Surrender unto me, yes. So, here we read in the purport that 23 that Absolute Truth is beyond measurement. One may ask how one can realize Him. Beyond measurement. That means with our own brain power, individual or collective, we cannot understand the truth about who we are, what this life is all about, and what Krishna is. Cannot do it. Because we are extremely tiny persons with very tiny intelligence. We may think that I'm very intelligent, but actually the reality is we have very small intelligence. So, how one can realize Him? The answer is given here by the words of Sambhuve. One may understand Him or not. So we may understand Him or we may not understand Him. But the reality, including His own spiritual potency, is existing all the time. And what you just said, only by surrendering to Krishna, then He can remove this misunderstanding. He can say, okay, Maya, this illusion, now give up the control of this person. Don't control this person anymore. That's how it happens. Krishna tells His controlling agency, do not control this person anymore. Free him from this illusion. So, somebody may say, oh yes, but you've had this disease not only for 1 week or 1 month or 1 year or one lifetime, but millions of lifetimes. So how long it will take to become free from this misunderstanding or disease? So what does Krishna say in other verses? He says, that's okay. No matter how long you've had this sickness, this misunderstanding, surrender unto me and immediately I can free you from this disease. Very strong cure Krishna can do, right? If somebody gives you a pill, that you take this one pill and immediately your cancer will be gone. It doesn't exist. Or you take this one pill and immediately your coronavirus is gone. It doesn't happen. It takes time. But Krishna says, you surrender unto me and I will tell Maya, okay, free this person. So our daily process, 24/7, morning to night, is with this moment that I have, with this body that I have, with this time I have, am I surrendering to Krishna or not? It's a moment by moment decision. To live our life as Krishna conscious devotees means that am I conscious of Krishna, what Krishna wants me to do right now, and is that what I'm doing with my life? So it's very important to retrain ourselves, which is what happens in the association of devotees, to retrain ourselves how to surrender to Krishna at every moment. One time Prabhupada was asked, what is the choice that we have? And Prabhupada said, the only choice you have is whether you surrender to Krishna or not. So, and surrender to Krishna, Prabhupada says, when we surrender to Krishna, that is the beginning of our, some of you remember what Prabhupada says about that? Beginning of our happy life. It's not the beginning of something we don't want, it's the beginning of our happy life. So everything becomes wonderful by simply this one act of surrendering to Krishna. And again, as I said, the surrendering process is not just once a week or once a day or once a year on some festival. It's every moment. Every moment we should live in such a way that we're doing what Krishna wants us to do. So then we can become free of all these diseases that have been created by much more powerful representatives of Krishna. All these bodies they have created, all these illusions, the three modes of material nature, all these things that we read about. All the curtains of illusion, they are removed very quickly. So I'll stop. Any questions or comments? Anybody, please say something. Somebody else, I'm sure you have so many nice realizations. Otherwise, I'll ask somebody to say something. Vasudeva Prabhu, please say some few words. Enlighten us.
So, Prabhu, you were mentioning that we have to be always conscious that we have to always conscious of Krishna every moment, whether I'm surrendered to Krishna. So how do I keep that? Because what happens during the day, we are so much busy with our services, and it sometimes happens that although we are doing service for Krishna, but that consciousness of Krishna, that I'm doing it for Krishna and I'm surrendered to Krishna, that mood is very difficult to maintain, that surrender, what you were speaking of.
Yeah.
So how do we devotees practically, you know, practice that so as to, you know, fulfill that condition of surrender?
I think you have the answer. You want to tell us? Why don't you give us your understanding? Then maybe I can say something.
I would like you to, if you could please enlighten us.
How do we stay in that consciousness of doing what Krishna wants us to do? You know, our whole training that we're getting, we're all in training camp here, or as Prabhupada says, we're in the hospital, right? This process Prabhupada has given us is very scientific. If you follow it properly, without offenses, as we read every morning about even the Maha Mantra, if you can not only practice, but practice without offenses, then that makes everything much more easy. If we practice with inattention, as we read in this verse today, because Sukadeva Goswami is saying, pay great attention. So in the Maha Mantra, we're chanting 16 rounds at least, minimum. What is the 11th so-called offense? To be inattentive while chanting the holy name of the Lord. So that inattention can go into the any types of 9 devotional services. Not only Maha Mantra, we can become inattentive any of the responsibilities that we have. So that inattention takes us away from what you're saying, thinking that I'm doing this for Krishna, because thinking of something else. So the process, it works, it's very scientific. Prabhupada was asked how long it takes to become Krishna conscious, and
in a moment.
What did he say sometimes? One moment.
Yeah.
That means you think he's just trying to give us some false hope? No. It's doable, it's possible. So we can remind each other that it doesn't have to take forever. Can help each other. We can remind each other that we can surrender to Krishna in one moment. And we can show that by our example. Association means we're always trying to set good example for other people. So we show by example, we show by strictly following, in all our services, we don't become inattentive. We can commit offenses not only in chanting, we can commit offenses also in doing our services. So being attentive, being careful, setting a good example, reminding each other, all these things can make a big difference. The most important thing to do out of all these different things, and Prabhupada has made this clear, 99% of our advancement comes from the association of devotees. So association of like-minded devotees who are following Srila Prabhupada obediently, without any other agenda, without any hypocrisy. This is the age of quarrel and hypocrisy. So honestly following Srila Prabhupada, where were we reading? Was it the morning about Prabhupada was saying honest? Yeah, it was this morning's reading. And from Nectar of Instruction about the qualifications for making advancement. And this was interesting that in this particular reading the word honesty was used. So that means opposite of that, dishonesty will not work. So to be with honest devotees and then follow the principles we heard this morning, all these things make things very easy. It's only when we are dishonest or we associate with dishonest people, that choice is there. This is the age of Kali. We'll have plenty of opportunities to associate with the wrong people. Plenty of opportunities. If you do that, then things become very problematic. So I don't know if that helps, but that's a little bit of an answer.
Thank you, Guru.
Thank you very much, Srila Prabhupada ki.
There's one question here.